everybody. Today I'm going to be talking about how trainers who don't use any forms of physical or psychological intimidation work with issues such as fear, reactivity, aggression, and overarousal in dogs. Now, in most cultures, it's commonly accepted that if there is an undesirable behavior, the best way to get rid of it is to punish it. However, this doesn't really teach the animal what they should do in that situation. And if the behavior is the side effect of an emotional state, if that emotional state isn't addressed, sometimes other behaviors will take the place of the behavior that's been punished that are related to the way the animal is feeling. So for example, if an animal was extremely frightened and that wasn't addressed, and the behavior that they exhibited when they were frightened, such as growling, was punished, then there might be other behaviors that are related to fear that crop up in the place where growling previously occurred. The undesirable behaviors can also be caused by something else that's happening in the animal's life. Here's a human example. There's a person that's stressed at work, maybe they're not getting enough sleep at night, or maybe they got in a little car accident and now they're chronically stressed, so they start to jump at little noises and it keeps getting worse and worse. So when the toaster pops, they go like that every time and overreact. And normally, if this was a dog's behavior, people would quickly turn to saying, oh, the dog's reacting to something in the environment, let's punish that behavior to make it go away. However, when you think of it in terms of a human jumping at a toaster, you wouldn't quickly turn to startling the person or causing pain to the person to get them to stop jumping at the toaster. Instead, you could create a behavior modification plan for this person to reduce the stress in their everyday life so they're no longer chronically stressed and overreacting to things that they shouldn't. If the problem didn't go away and they were still jumping at things, they could then use counterconditioning and desensitization by letting the person know that the toaster is just about to pop and having it pop while the person is prepared for it to happen, and then perhaps making the person a cup of tea afterwards, or habituating the person to it by constantly having the toaster pop and then creating time in between when the toaster pops. However, sometimes by simply just reducing the stress in the person's life, all those problems of jumping at noises and overreacting to being touched all go away. Now I'm going to talk about some similar examples, but in a dog's world. Perhaps there's a dog that's in pain. Maybe he has back pain or hip pain that the owner might not even know about, and at night he's just not getting enough sleep that he should be getting because of the pain. He could also be at a daycare where it looks like he's having a marvelous time, but perhaps he's overexcited the whole day and he's just not thinking to get the amount of sleep that he needs to. Or perhaps the dog has anxiety about being left alone and gets left alone 8 hours every day, where the dog is worrying the whole time that the owner is outside of the house. And in all these cases, what could be happening is that the dog is getting chronically stressed and it starts to show when the dog starts to react to things that he never reacted to or starts to overreact. For example, maybe a dog inside the house that has been anxious about their owner coming home, then out on a walk, starts jumping at noises and jumping when they see people coming down the street. And for dogs, jumping might include lunging and barking, because that's what dogs do when they're startled. When they startle, a lot of dogs will bark and lunge at whatever it is that startled them. So as you can see, if someone was trying to solve a behavior problem of a dog lunging and barking at people or dogs on the street, and the dog is chronically stressed because of an issue with separation anxiety, just punishing the side effect that was caused by the separation anxiety problem and the chronic stress, you can see that other behavior problems might pop up and replace that reactive barking behavior that the dog was exhibiting. So in my type of training, the real method of solving the lunging and barking problem is to look at the animal's everyday life and see if there's something that's causing the dog to overreact to things in the environment. Regarding the human example, where the person was in a small car crash or maybe even a big car crash, some people's behavior might not be affected by that, while other people might start sensitizing to noises and being touched on the shoulder, for example, And dogs are very similar. So for me, I like to consider when a dog's walking down the street and another dog charges them from behind a fence, some dogs don't get affected by that and they continue on with their lives, their happy-go-lucky lives, and other dogs can be affected by it in the same way as a small car crash. The dog experiences this very startling and sometimes even traumatic event. They don't know that the other dog is behind a fence, and they see a dog that's charging and barking at them and throwing all the warning signs that they're about to be attacked and then screech to a halt at a fence. Now, just one dog doing that can cause a dog to start to be hypervigilant of their environment on a walk. And if every walk turns into an experience where the dog is looking over their shoulder for something terrible to happen, the dog can start to become chronically stressed. When an animal is overreacting to stimuli in the environment, or perhaps even sensitizing, meaning their reactions are becoming more and more intense, those moments are probably not the moments that will be the most beneficial to train the animal, because the animal most likely is over threshold. For example, they're exhibiting signs of fear, reactivity, aggression, or overexcitement. Even compulsion trainers who use punishment understand that an animal is not going to experience pain and startle in the same way when they're over threshold. For example, if a dog was chasing a deer and somebody slapped a shock collar on the dog most likely, without any training, is going to keep chasing the deer and not even notice that he's getting electrocuted in his neck. And the same is true for using positive reinforcement, counterconditioning, and desensitization, is that if you try to train the animal when they're experiencing extreme fear, anxiety, and are reacting already, you're not going to create the most efficient training plan. So the real key to awesome training is to create a training plan where you're not sending the animal over threshold to rehearse the behaviors that you find undesirable. And this really means that you need to use management and prevention if you want to change your animal's behavior, and set up training sessions in a way that your animal isn't feeling those emotions that are going to send them over the top. For example, fear, anxiety, or anger and aggression. When working on a dog's behavior problems using positive reinforcement in conjunction with counterconditioning and desensitization, the goal is on teaching the dog what you do want him to do in the situations that he's been offering the undesirable behavior and potentially behaviors that are unhealthy for him. The goal also is to change the dog's emotional response when in these situations, because if you simply teach your dog to sit, but he's still scared of something, then other undesirable behaviors might crop up in the future. So the real goal with this type of training is that you're creating a dog that's calm and confident and relaxed around the stimuli that was previously making the dog overexcited, fearful, or aggressive. So that is why you might notice that the same behavior modification plans are used for a dog that is scared of someone, a dog that's really excited and happy and wants to see the person, or that the dog wants to bite the person. You're using the same plan because the end goal is the same. You want a calm, confident dog that is offering the friendly social behavior, or you want the dog to simply ignore whatever it is in the environment. The key to successful training is being able to control the environment and the things that your dog reacts to, as well as being able to read your dog and know when to lower and raise criteria in a training session. Now, some dogs can go out and about and you can change their emotional response and train them new behaviors, appropriate behaviors to do when out and about at a park or on a walk, when they see their triggers that potentially make them react. But for other dogs, this is just too much of a first step. When you go out and about with a dog and you try to change their emotional response when they're feeling anxious about being out on a walk, or they had the separation anxiety problem and they're all stressed out from that, chronically stressed, and you're trying to modify their behavior on the street where they're hypervigilant and looking for other dogs to bark at, that's simply not going to work. And it's extremely beneficial to create training setups where you manage the environment in between training, keeping your dog under threshold, and then set up training setups where things progress in small, easy steps for the dog, where the dog is learning not to react in the way that they previously did and to feel calm and relaxed and ignore whatever's in the environment or act friendly and social towards it. I wrote a protocol for emotional and behavioral modification, and I'll put a link to that in the description below so you can find out more about it. In this coming year, I plan to make more videos with different types of dogs of different types of breeds to show you how to use the protocol. A question that I frequently get asked is, don't you need to be able to see the dog's problem behavior first in order to solve it? And the answer is no. I don't want to see the dog's problem behavior because I don't want them rehearsing that behavior again just so I have the pleasure of seeing the dog over their threshold. Instead, what happens with this type of training is that you find out about the problem as you progress through your training. So if you were doing a counter conditioning exercise where you're working with a dog who you know the owner has said that the dog lunges and barks at people or dogs, you start out with the easiest step and their ability to progress to the next level of criteria, how fast they can do it. And when you present different stimuli and different situations to the dog and how well they cope, you find out what issues the dog is having. But you don't find out about them by the dog suddenly lunging and barking at the person. You find out maybe when the dog suddenly can't look back to get his treat, or the dog starts to stare at the person for 2 seconds. Then you would lower criteria. So you can progress through training without ever actually seeing the previous behavior that the dog used to do and focus on only seeing the behaviors you want the dog to do. Of course, we all try to achieve errorless learning in our training where we're setting the dog up for success, but every once in a while, the dog will regress, and when training is done correctly, it will be very mild. So maybe the dog might woof once at the person where in the past it was extreme lunging and barking with hair raised, dilated pupils, and foaming at the mouth. But in the training session, it might just look like a little woof, or that the dog just suddenly stands up when they were in a calm settle. So that's how we find out about what previously used to happen in the past. I hope you found this video helpful for your training. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe to channel KikoPup. You can also become a supporting member of this channel by clicking the join button. See you later, guys. Bye.